One of the most important lessons that we seek to teach children is the value of sharing. Sharing is something that is so important, and yet it can sometimes be very difficult. We like to hold on to things that are our own, whether it's our stuff or our feelings or emotions or our thoughts. But when it comes to communion, one of the wonderful things about it is that it is a sharing. It is a sharing of our thoughts. It is a sharing of celebration because of our faith, which is also shared. Hello, welcome to First Baptist Church for this special Maundy Thursday Communion Service. I'm Pastor Matthew Coleman. And in just a few moments, we're going to share the elements of communion. So I invite you, if you haven't already, to get some bread and some juice or something that you can use that will symbolize these elements as we share what we have in common. No, we may not be in the same room together, but our faith unites us, even at a distance. So today, in honor of Maundy Thursday, we share communion. And in preparation for that, let me share with you a passage from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, his first letter that the Lord inspired him to write. In the 11th chapter, in verse 23, we read these words: "For this is what the Lord himself has said about his table, and I have passed it on to you before, that on the night when Judas betrayed him, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to God for it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, 'Take this and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new agreement between God and you. It has been established and set in motion by my blood. Do this in remembrance of me whenever you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are retelling the message of the Lord's death, that he has died for you. Do this until he comes again.'" Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, what a powerful passage of Scripture. What a powerful reminder for us that as we take the opportunity to share in the elements, to share in the bread and the juice, that it is a retelling of the message of what Christ has done for us individually and collectively. And Father God, I pray that as we unite through technology this day, that your Spirit would be present with us. We pray that you would offer your strength and your encouragement, your peace and your hope. We pray that you would pour out upon each one of us your love in a special way as we unite our hearts together to remember what you have done for us in sending your Son Jesus to sacrifice his life for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The act of communion, or the Lord's Supper, or as some call it, the Eucharist, is very simple. There's the breaking of bread and the passing of it and the passing of juice. It's something that's very easy to do, and so very often in those easy actions that we observe or celebrate, it's very easy to lose the significance or the meaning of it. And so Today, as we prepare to partake of the elements, let us remember that communion is meant to be something that causes us to look to God. First, we look back to God and see what He has done for us in the past. And when I say us, what He's done for us collectively and individually. Yes, we know that God is our great Creator. Yes, we know that everything that was created by Him and through Him and for Him. But we know also that before the very foundations of the world, because of His omniscience and omnipotence and omnipresence, He knew that humanity would fall and would need a Savior in order for us to be restored into a relationship with Him. So He set in motion the plan, even before the foundation of the world, that would ultimately bring Jesus to the cross. So, as we partake of communion today, take a moment to look back at what God has done for you and for me. And look back, too, at the many ways that He has blessed us. You know, I know that each of us struggle in our own ways. Current circumstances have caused chaos in the lives of so many people. But don't allow those current circumstances to distract you from the truth of how God has worked and how He has worked mightily in your life over the past. So today, as we prepare to take communion, we look back. We also look forward, because in communion we are reminded of what Jesus Christ has done, what He's accomplished for us, so that one day we can have fellowship, perfect fellowship with God in paradise. We know Scripture tells us that when we are absent from this body, we're going to be present with the Lord. Scripture tells us that we aren't to allow our hearts to be troubled, because God has prepared a place for us. And so we look forward to that day when Christ will return, when Christ will come again. So we look back. We look forward. And as we celebrate communion, may we also look upward to our great God, our faithful God, our glorious God, our worthy God. You know, so often the actions that we take them, and as we do them, we think about how it impacts us. And you know what? There are a lot of things that do impact us. But when we observe communion, may we humble ourselves and focus not on simply what God has done for us, but focus also on God and who He is. Not just what He's done for us, but who He is in His essence, in His character, in His personality. Because you know what? Our God is a great God, even if He never, ever did anything that resulted in our salvation. Our God is majestic. Our God is sovereign. Our God is in control. Our God is God. And sometimes we go, yes, we worship Him because He did this. But our God is worthy of worship, even if He does nothing that benefits us. But in His grace, He has. So today, as we worship the Lord, as we celebrate the Lord, as we remember what God has done for us, as we remember what Jesus Christ has done for us, let us fully cast our eyes on Jesus. Let us fully cast our eyes on God and celebrate who He is. And He is amazing. As we turn to the elements now, let us remember the symbolism. First, at that supper, the Passover supper, when Jesus and the disciples observed that Passover, Again, we are mindful that it was a demonstration or a remembrance of how the Hebrew children were delivered from oppression by the Egyptians. And we remember and celebrate that through Jesus Christ, we too have been delivered from the oppression of sin. And Jesus took the bread and he broke it. And as he broke it, he reminded them that that bread symbolized his body, the breaking of his body. He was broken in order that we would be made whole, we would be made complete. And he gave thanks, and he passed that bread to his disciples, those that sat around the table, those that had journeyed with him through a variety of different communities, those that had seen him do mighty miracles. They were together, and they shared that bread. They shared what symbolized the body of Jesus, the broken body of Jesus. And we do the same today. We share the broken body of Jesus, but we also share the consequences, the result. Through his brokenness, we are whole. Let us pray. Father God, as we contemplate your broken body, we give you thanks. We give you praise. We thank you, Jesus, that you were willing to walk that walk, to take that journey that led to the cross in our place. We thank you that you suffered terribly for us. And we pray, Lord God, that as we, as one people, as one church, as one congregation, that as we assemble over technology, that your Spirit would minister to each of our spirits, that you would give us comfort and encouragement, and that you would strengthen the relationship that we have, that you would unite us together as brothers and sisters in Christ, that we would be able to experience the wholeness that is only possible through you. In Jesus' name we pray. After the breaking of bread, Jesus took the cup. And in that cup, there was wine. And that wine symbolized the new covenant, the new agreement that was between God and man. And that cup, the liquid that it held, it represents the blood of Jesus Christ. And we know that Scripture tells us that without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sin. There can be no payment of sin. And so Jesus allowed his blood to be spilled for our benefit, for our eternal benefit. And so after the cup, after the bread, Jesus took the cup and again gave thanks. And we do the same. As we hold these cups and as we think about what Jesus has accomplished for us through the shedding of his blood, let us too give thanks to God. Let us remember what Christ has accomplished. Let us remember how the Holy Spirit has worked, how he has sealed us, how he has guaranteed us salvation as a result of our faith in Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Again, Lord, we humbly come before you today. lifting this cup, which is symbolic of the blood of Jesus Christ, which was spilled for us. And Father, as we think about it today, we pray, Lord God, that you would help us to never take for granted what Jesus has done, that we would recognize that he has paid the price, that it is his blood that has washed us white as snow. And Lord, we pray that as we embrace this gift of grace, that we would extend it to the lives of others, to those that look different than us, that talk different than us, that do things differently than we do, that we would offer them the love of Jesus, that we would share with them the truth of the gospel of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ and him alone, that we would proudly declare our faith in our great Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, that we would come before him regularly, seeking his direction, his guidance, through the reading of his word, through prayer. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is truth. We thank you that it tells us of Jesus and that Last Supper, Jesus, and that Passover meal when he encouraged us to unite, and as we do this, to remember what Christ has accomplished for us. And so that is what we do. In the name of Jesus Christ. In just a moment, we'll play a song. And as that song is played, I want to encourage you to just spend some time and respond to the Lord quietly where you are, as individuals or as family. I encourage you to think about what Jesus has done for you. Think about the blessing that we have as a result of what Christ has done. Earlier today, in our Thoughtful Thursday video, we talked about Maundy Thursday and the mandate that Jesus gave us in that commandment to love others as he has loved us. And again, I want to encourage you, if you haven't yet done that, to find somebody in your life, somebody that maybe the Lord has laid on your heart, hopefully it's somebody the Lord has laid on your heart, that is in need of a demonstration of love. Maybe it's somebody that lives in the same home that you do, somebody that lives next door, somebody that lives across the country. Today, in honor of the love that Jesus has shown us, won't you reach out to them and share that love? And in so doing, you can remember what Christ has done for us. God bless you this Maundy Thursday.
To receive. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you. And remembrance leads us to worship. And as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you. See his body, his blood, know that he has overcome every trial we will face. None too lost to be saved, none too broken or ashamed, all are welcome in this place. By your mercy we come to your table. Grace, you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you. And remembrance leads us to worship. And as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. Respond to your invitation. We remember you. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restore our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Jesus, come in glory. Jesus, come. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we respond to your invitation.